Hi everyone, welcome to Chemi Friends. How are you all? I hope you guys are doing really well. So here I am with Gate 2001 Solutions, and the link of the question paper is in the description box below. You can download it from there, and as I always say that try doing it once without looking at the solution, and even if you don't want to do it, it's okay, you can directly watch the video. So let's start.
First question. The value of the following determinant is?
The determinant for this particular matrix is the product of its diagonal elements, which is 24. One thing that we should keep in mind is that for upper triangular matrix and lower triangular matrix, the determinant is the product of its diagonal elements.
Next, the value of 1 plus I to the power 8. You have to find out the value of 1 plus I to the power 8.
1 plus I to the power 8 can be written as this. All we need to do is just expand 1 plus I to the power 2. 1 and 1 will get cancelled and we will left with 2I square. So we know that I square is minus 1, substitute it and then square it again. So the final answer is 16.
Third question. A reasonably general expression for vapor liquid phase equilibrium at low to moderate pressure is given as this following expression. The value of K is a function of, the four options are given, you have to tell at which particular parameter the value of K will depend.
It is given in the question that Ki is equals to Yi upon Xi. Therefore, from the equation, Ki is equals to gamma I phi and Fi naught upon phi I into P. So gamma I, which is liquid activity coefficient, depends on temperature, pressure and liquid phase composition. Fi naught, which is fugacity of pure component, depends on temperature and pressure. And phi, which is vapor phase fugacity coefficient, depends on temperature and pressure. Since Ki is a function of all these parameters, therefore, Ki will be depending on temperature, pressure and liquid phase composition.
Fourth question. High pressure steam is expanded adiabatically and reversible through a well-insulated turbine which produces some shaft work. If the enthalpy change and entropy change across the turbine is represented as delta H and delta S, you have to find out a particular condition for this process.
It's a conceptual question. So for an adiabatic process, adiabatic and reversible process, we know that heat transfer is not taking place in adiabatic process, therefore delta Q will be zero. So delta S is equals to delta Q by T. Since delta Q is zero, delta S, which is entropy, will also be zero. And in case of adiabatic and reversible process, enthalpy is not equals to zero.
Next, for the case of a fuel gas undergoing combustion with air, if the air to fuel ratio is increased, the adiabatic flame temperature will?
The adiabatic temperature will decrease if the air to fuel ratio is increased.
1.6. The power number of a stirred tank becomes constant at high Reynolds number. The variation of power input with impeller rotational speed is proportional to?
It is given in the question that power number is constant at high Reynolds number. So for this, NP is directly proportional to P, which is power consumption, upon rho N cube by dA to the power 5, where N is the number of rotation, D is the impeller dia and NP is power number. Since power number is constant, so the power consumption will vary N to the power 3, as we can see from the relation.
1.7. The operation of a rotameter is based on, and the four options are given, you have to choose the correct one.
The correct answer is variable flow area. Rotameter is a device which is used to measure volumetric flow rate of a fluid.
1.8. Applying a pressure drop across a capillary results in a volumetric flow rate Q under laminar flow conditions. The flow rate for the pressure drop in a capillary of the same length but half the radius is. Okay, now the conditions have been changed. You have to find out how the flow rate will vary.
Volumetric flow rate is area into velocity. Also the conditions are laminar, so we can use Hagen-Poiseuille equation, and we can see from here that volumetric flow rate varies linearly with radius to the power 4. For the new condition, that is R2 is half of R1, we can take the ratio, and in place of R2 we can substitute R1 by 2. Now here the volumetric flow rate is 1/16th times the original volumetric flow rate.
1.9. The heat transfer by radiation from a mild steel surface is to be reduced by reducing the emissivity of the surface. This can be best achieved by...
In this scenario, it would be great if we paint the surface white.
Moving on to the next question. Heat transfer by natural convection is enhanced in systems with...
In natural convection, Nusselt number is a function of Grashof number and Prandtl number. Grashof number is represented by this and Prandtl number is represented by this. We all know that Nusselt number is HAL by K, where H is the heat transfer coefficient. So there are other factors on which this heat transfer coefficient will depend, but the heat transfer will be enhanced in a system with high coefficient of thermal expansion.
In 1.11, you have to tell the relation for surface removal theory.
The correct option is C, which is KL square by dA.
Moving on to 1.12. For a gas absorption, the height of a transfer unit based on gas phase is given by, and the four options are given.
From these four options, option A is correct.
The Lewis relation for air-water humidification is given by...
Here, option C is correct. For question 11, 12 and 13, if you want to refer to the detailed derivations, you can refer to any mass transfer book, and it's better if you remember all these relations.
In 1.14, we have to find out the conversion in batch mode for a second order irreversible reaction.
The second order rate equation is K2 Ca square. We know that Ca is equals to Ca0 1 minus Xa. So we have substituted that here. And we can observe that Ca0 and 1 Ca0 from here will get cancelled. So we are left with this equation. We can take 1 minus Xa square to the LHS and dT to the RHS and put the limits from 0 to Xa and 0 to T. Now we have to solve these two integrals. For solving this, you can take a look here, which is nothing but basic 11th standard mathematics. I have just taken 1 minus xa as t, changed the limits and solved it, and then I got xa 1 minus xa. Similarly, now coming back to here, we wanted conversion. So for conversion, on doing little bit of modification, we got conversion is equals to K2 Ca0 T 1 plus K2 Ca0 T.
In 1.15, we have to tell how the rate constants are related at two different temperatures.
From Arrhenius theory, we know that K is equals to AE to the power minus E by RT, where E is the activation energy, R is gas constant, T is temperature. For two different temperatures, we can take the ratio, and on solving that, we get ln K2 by K1 is equals to E by R 1 by T1 minus 1 by T2.
Moving on to 1.16, the E curve for non-ideal reactor defines the fraction of fluid having age between T and T plus dT.
For this, the correct answer is at the outlet, E curve for a non-ideal reactor defines the fraction of fluid having age between T and T plus dT at the outlet.
Moving on to 1.18, a process is initially at steady state with its output and the input is also given. The input is suddenly changed to 2 at time T equals 0. The output response is also given. We have to find out the transfer function for this particular process.
The transfer function is given as ys upon xs. Now we will introduce the deviation variables. So it's nothing but the difference between the variables and their steady state values. So we will get yt is equals to 2t. We'll just take the Laplace transform to get the value of ys. Similarly, we will get the value of xs by introducing the deviation variable and taking the Laplace transform. Now the transfer function is ys upon xs. Therefore, the answer is 2 upon s.
1.19. The inherent characteristics of an equal percentage valve relating flow rate with valve stem movement x is described by the equation.
The correct option is A.
Moving on to 1.20. A perforated plate has holes of diameter dh arranged in a pitch. Each hole has a tube of dp passing through it. The ligament efficiency is given by...
Here the correct option is C.
Next, the ends of a cylindrical vessel can be closed by a head, which can be one of the four shapes. For the same thickness, choose the one which can withstand the highest pressure.
So, hemispherical head can withstand highest pressure.
Moving on to 1.22, an investment of rupees 100 lakhs is to be made for construction of a plant, which will take 2 years to start production. The annual profit from the operation of the plant is 20 lakhs. What would be the payback time?
We know that payback time is fixed capital investment upon annual profit. Plus, we will also take the time before the start of the plant, which is 2 years. So, we will substitute the value of fixed capital investment and the annual profit. So, we'll get payback time is equals to 7 years.
Moving on to 1.23. One of the steps during refining of sugar consists of addition of hydrated lime to the sugar syrup followed by carbonation. The purpose of this particular step is to...
The purpose of this step is to adjust the pH of the syrup.
1.24. Styrene is produced from ethyl benzene by the process of...
In this, option A is correct, that is, styrene is produced from ethyl benzene by the process of dehydrogenation.
Moving on to the last question of section 1. In the fluid catalytic cracker, the cracking reaction is dash and the regeneration is... Okay, we have to tell whether it's an exothermic or an endothermic reaction for both the reactions.
The cracking reaction is endothermic in nature and the regeneration is exothermic in nature. That is, option D is correct. So this was the end of section 1. I hope everything is good till now and you guys are understanding everything. Now we'll move to section 2.
Next, 2.1. The function this has the maximum or the minimum at. We have to specify the conditions.
This is a multivariable problem. For this, you need to find out first order derivative with respect to x and y, second order derivatives with respect to x and y, and second order derivative of x with respect to y. Then find out the critical points by equating del f by del x is equals to 0 and del f by del y is equals to 0. When you equate del f by del x is equals to 0, you will get y as 2x minus 1. Substitute this value of y in this, which is 2y minus x minus 1 is equals to 0, you will get x is equals to 1. When you substitute this x is equals to 1 here, you will get y as 1. Therefore, the critical points are 1, 1. Now, we need to find out whether it is a maxima or minima. For this, we will do a second derivative test. We have already found out the values of second order derivatives of x and y. So, substitute those in this formula, which is second order derivative of x multiplied by second order derivative of y minus second order derivative of x with respect to y squared. When we substitute these values, we will get the value of d as 3, which is greater than 0. Now, this is greater than 0. All we need to look is del 2f by del x square is equal to 0, less than 0, or greater than 0. Since that is also greater than 0, we will have a minima at 1, 1.
Next question, a fair die is rolled 4 times. Find the probability that 6 shows up twice.
This can be solved by using binomial distribution, which is NCR, p to the power r, q, n minus r, where n is the number of trials. In this case, it is 4. R is the required number of success. That means we need 6 to show up 2 times, which is 2 in this case. P is the probability of success and q is the probability of failure. So here we need 6. So 6 will show up 1 time, that is 1 by 6, and the probability of failure is 5 by 6. So on solving this, we will get 25 by 216, which is the probability of 6 showing up 2 times.
So this question is related to purging. All the mole percentage of the components have been given and we have to find out the flow rate of the purge stream.
So this is a process of isomerization. We can take feed flow rate as X, purge flow rate as Y, and product flow rate as Z, which is 70 kilomoles per hour. And we need to find out purge flow rate, which is Y. So we can apply overall balance, which is X is equals to Y plus Z. We know the value of Z. So this is equation 1. Now we will be doing component balance over impurity, because we know the impurity in the flow rate, feed flow rate, and impurity in the purge stream. So by doing that, we get Y is equals to 5 kilomoles per hour. You just have to substitute 2 in 1 and then get the value of Y.
The Maxwell relation derived from the differential expression for the Helmholtz free energy is?
The fundamental property relation for Helmholtz free energy is minus PdV minus SdT, because here TdS will get cancelled and we are left with minus PdV minus SdT. So we will make use of exact differential equation, that is dz is equals to mdx plus ndy. All we need to do is just compare these two equations. For example, m will be equal to minus p, n will be equal to minus s, x will be v and y will be t, and final step would be substituting all the values of m, n, x and y in this form. As you can see that here I have done the same. So the relation is del P by del T at constant volume is equals to del S by del V at constant temperature.
Next, 2.5. At 100 degrees Celsius, water and methyl cyclohexane both have vapor pressures of 1 atmosphere. Also, at 100 degrees Celsius, the latent heat of vaporization of these compounds are given. And the vapor pressure of water at 150 degrees Celsius is 4.69. So at 150, the vapor pressure of methyl cyclohexane would be expected to.
We will use Clausius-Clapeyron equation. So for methyl hexane and water, we know the values of vapor pressure at 100 degrees Celsius, and we need to find out the vapor pressure at 150 degrees Celsius of methyl cyclohexane. We know both the temperatures and we know the latent heat of vaporization of both the compounds. So we will substitute the value here, and similarly for water. Now we will divide both the equations, and on dividing we will be left with this. So from here we can find out the vapor pressure of methyl cyclohexane at 150 degrees Celsius, which is 3.32 atmosphere. And this value is significantly less than 4.69 atmosphere. So option A is correct.
Moving on to 2.6. A Bingham fluid of viscosity and yield stress is sheared between flat parallel plates separated by a distance. The top plate is moving with the velocity of 1 meter per second. We have to find out the shear stress on the plate.
We know that for a Bingham fluid, tau is equals to tau naught plus mu dv over dy. So we know the value of dv and dy. Just substitute it, we'll get 10 to the power 3 second inverse. Now we know tau naught, we know the value of viscosity. All we have to do is just substitute in this equation 1 and tau is equals to 20 kilopascal.
2.17. Air enters an adiabatic compressor at 300 Kelvin. Now we have to find out the exit temperature for a compression ratio of 3.
This is the relation for adiabatic process. We knew the compression ratio, we knew the value of gamma, we knew the value of T1. All we need to do is substitute here, and on doing that we will get the exit temperature as 300 into 3 to the power 2 by 7.
Moving on to 2.8, this question is related to mechanical operations. So we have to find out the energy required to grind the particles from a very large size to 50 micrometers.
Bond's law is represented by this relation, and for taking the ratio for the two components E2 by E1, we know the value of E1, we know the value of diameter of particle 1 and diameter of particle 2. All we need to do is substitute these values and we will get the energy as 18 kilowatt hours per ton.
Next, the Cedar-Tate correlation for heat transfer and turbulent flow in pipes is given as, okay, now assume that this relation is valid. The heat transfer coefficient varies with pipe diameter as.
We know that Nusselt number depends on Reynolds number to the power 0.8. All we need to do is expand them. That is, Nusselt number will get expanded to HD by K, where H is heat transfer coefficient, D diameter, K thermal conductivity. And Reynolds number will be rho Vd by mu, where rho is density, V is velocity, D diameter, mu viscosity. Now we will take this D to RHS, and from there we'll get to know that D to the power minus 0.2 is the correct answer.
Next question. The overall heat transfer coefficient is given. Fouling factor is also given. We have to find out the overall heat transfer coefficient at this time.
The overall heat transfer coefficient in this case can be found out by adding overall heat transfer coefficient of clean surface and fouling factor of dirty surface. So we know both the values. All we need to do is substitute them, and then we can find out overall heat transfer coefficient, which is 333 watt per meter square Kelvin.
Moving on to the next question. The heat flux across an insulating wall is given along with thermal conductivity and thickness values. The temperature of inside wall is also given. We have to calculate the temperature of outside wall.
We know that heat flux is Q by A, which is equals to K into temperature gradient, which is delta T by delta X, and K is thermal conductivity. We know the value of heat flux, we know the value of K. Delta T is outside wall temperature minus inside wall temperature. So that inside wall temperature also we know the value of delta X. All we need to do is substitute them and calculate the value of outside temperature, that is 35 degree Celsius.
2.12. The interfacial area per unit volume of dispersion in a gas liquid contactor is given as.
In this question, we will take the basis of 1 meter cube of gas liquid contactor. So epsilon, we know that it is total volume of bubbles to the total volume of gas liquid contactor, and the volume of gas liquid contactor is 1 meter cube, and the total volume of bubbles is n into 4 by 3 pi r cube, where n is the number of bubbles. So from here n is equals to 3 epsilon 4 pi r cube. Also we know that interfacial area of n bubbles is n into 4 pi r square, that is the surface area of sphere. Now we know the value of n. You can substitute the value of n from here, and the interfacial area is 6 epsilon by d. You know the value of epsilon, that is 0.1. we know the value of d, 0.5 mm. So we need to convert it into meters, that is why 10 to the power 3. And the area is 1200 meter square per meter cube.
2.13. 200 kg of solid is subjected to a drying process for a period of 5000 seconds. Okay, All the values are given. We have to find out the moisture content at the end of the drying period.
For finding out the final moisture content, this is the particular relation which we will use. Also, I would like you to notice that area is in the form of 4 meters square per 100 kg. So we will multiply it by mass, and hence we will get the area in terms of meter square. Hence the unit consistency is also important. Now substitute all these values here. Rate is also given, mass is also given, area is given, time of drying is given, initial moisture content is also given. So the final moisture content is 0.1.
In a single stage extraction process, 10 kg of pure solvent is mixed with 30 kg of feed. So we have to find out the total mass of the extract phase.
So this is about single stage extraction. It is better to draw a diagram so that all the things are clear. We know that feed is 30 kgs, solvent is 10 kgs, the compositions are also given, and we need to find out the extract phase. And for that we will do overall balance, which is input is equals to output, F plus S is equals to E plus R, and we know the value of F and S, that is feed and solvent, so E plus R is equals to 40, and we have marked it as equation 1. Next, component balance. When we will do the component balance, all we need to do is just substitute the value of R from equation 1 and solve it. Otherwise, all the values are given. And when we solve, extract phase is equals to 8.89 kgs.
Next question. The mean conversion in the exit stream for second order liquid phase reaction in non-ideal flow reactor is given by...
For a second order batch reactor and non-ideal system, we can write Ca bar by Ca naught as 0 to infinity 1 plus K2 Ca naught T ET dT. And Ca bar by Ca naught is nothing but 1 minus conversion. And from here, conversion can be written as 1 minus 0 to infinity 1 by 1 plus K2 Ca naught T ET dT. Now we know that 1 is 0 to infinity ET dT, and hence we can write this in place of 1. Now we will take common ET dT from both the terms and write it like this. So the conversion is 0 to infinity K2 Ca naught T upon 1 plus K2 Ca naught T ET dT.
Next, in this particular question, the scheme reaction scheme follows Elly-Riddle mechanism, and we have to find out the rate of reaction.
It is given that reaction step is rate controlling. So for this, option A is correct. And if you want to see the detailed derivation, you can refer to Fogler book.
Next, the first order gas phase reaction is conducted isothermally in batch mode. So we need to find out the change of conversion with time.
So when we talk about first order and gas phase reaction, volume expansion factor comes into the picture, which is the change in number of moles after the complete conversion of A to the initial number of moles. So volume expansion factor here is 1, and we all know that for first order the rate equation is given as minus 1 by V dNA by dt K1 Ca. We know that Na is Na0 1 minus Xa, and V is V0 1 plus epsilon A Xa. We can substitute the value of epsilon. Also, Ca is Ca0 1 minus Xa upon 1 plus epsilon A Xa for gas phase reaction. So, Na0 by V0 becomes Ca0, which will be cancelled with this. And what we are left with, dxa by dt is equals to k1 1 minus xa.
The transfer function of PID controller is given, and we have to find out the frequency at which magnitude ratio of the controller is 1.
So it's a PID controller, and the equation this resembles like this. So tau d is 0.2 and tau I is 0.5, and the magnitude ratio of a PID controller is given by this. If you want to have a detailed derivation, you can refer to any process control book, and by substituting the values of tau D and tau I, we will get this. All you need to do is just square, cancel out the terms, that's it. And the frequency can be find out by taking 1 over 0.5 omega to RHS, and the omega is 1 over under root 0.2 into 0.5, which is the frequency.
Next question. The block diagram is given and we need to find out the offset exhibited by the system.
So offset is the difference between the ultimate value of the set point and the ultimate value of the response. So for finding out the response, we need to first find the transfer function. So the transfer function is given by kc into 2 into 1 by 2s upon 1 plus kc into 2 into 1 by 2s. 2 and 2 will get cancelled, so we will be left with kc upon s plus kc. So we know that transfer function is by s by xs. So x here is unit step, that is y 1 by s. And if so, ys is equals to 1 by s into kc upon 1 plus s plus kc. So when we find out the response of that transfer function, so we will be getting 1 minus e to the power minus kc into t. All you need to do is make use of partial fractions in that also. And offset is given, already given set point, which is 1. And the ultimate value of this response will be 1, because e to the power minus infinity is 0. Therefore, 1 minus 1, 0, offset will be 0.
Next, a second order system can be obtained by connecting two first order system in series. The damping ratio of the resultant second order system for the case tau 1 not equal to tau 2 will be?
The transfer function for first order system in series will result in a second order system, and it can be written as like this. And if you have to find out the damping ratio, all you need to do is just compare it with the general equation. So here tau will be under root tau 1 tau 2 on comparing both these two equations. And zeta, which is damping ratio, will be tau 1 plus tau 2 to tau, where tau is under root tau 1 tau 2. So this has to be greater than 1 for tau 1 not equals to tau 2.
In the next question, we have to find out the value of investment at the end of 5 years. Interest is given and the principal amount is also given.
The value after 5 years can be find out by this formula. P is the investment which you made at the starting, R is the rate of interest, M is the number of intervals per year, that is whether it is annually or quarterly, N is the number of years for which the investment is made. So we know that P is 1000, R, that is rate of interest, is 10%, which is 0.1, M is 4 because it is quarterly, and N is 5. So when we do the product here, 5 into 4 is 20. So the correct answer is this.
Next, the depreciation for the mth year by the sum of years digit method will be?
If you are familiar with this method, that is sum of years digits method, you will know that depreciation for the mth year will be represented by option D. Hence, it is the correct answer.
In 2.23, we have to tell the relation between longitudinal stress and the circumferential stress.
Here, sigma h is circumferential stress, which is P d by 2 times t. P is pressure, d is diameter, and t is thickness. And longitudinal stress is P d upon 4 times thickness. So, if you multiply 2 with the longitudinal stress, the relation which will be satisfied is sigma h is equals to 2 times sigma l, which is option A.
In 2.24, the equilibrium conversion of sulfur dioxide will increase or decrease with the increase in temperature, or will increase or decrease with the increase in mole ratio of sulfur dioxide to air.
So the correct option is B. It will decrease with increase in temperature and increase with increase in the mole ratio.
Next, for the hydrogenation of oils, which is the common catalyst and which one is the catalyst poison?
The common catalyst is nickel and catalyst poison is sulfur. So option C is correct.
Now we are moving towards the end of the video. If you guys have any problem, you can write to us via email or you can comment also. So it's very important to get the concepts right. Therefore, I'll be putting the names of the books that I have been religiously following all these years. Also, you can watch our previous videos on our channel, and don't forget to like, share, and subscribe.